topic of the international perspectives and the current initiatives for Kashmir that are happening. And then after that, we will do a question and answer session. So please do type in your questions in the comments section, and we will answer them afterwards. And if you still have more questions, you can engage with them. We can all see your questions and your comments. So just keep them coming, inshallah, and we will discuss them after Dr. Ghulam Nabi's talk, inshallah. Okay, Dr. Ghulam Nabi, go ahead, inshallah.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. First of all, let me thank ICNA, Council of Social Justice, and Dr. Zahid Bukhari and Ramiz Abid for organizing this very important and timely webinar. The people who are listening to us are watching this program, so they may be thinking the title, an open air prison, is a fictional title. But let me tell you, not at all. It is a statement of fact. So why I am saying that? Because I am going to give you two important examples why it is an open air prison. First example takes us back to 2004, to be exact, the July of 2004, when European Parliament, they sent a delegation to Kashmir by the Foreign Affairs Committee. It was headed by John Cushnan of Ireland. They stayed in Kashmir for a week, and they came back and reported to the Foreign Affairs Committee of the European Parliament. And the title of the report was Kashmir, the Most Beautiful Prison on Earth. So you may be thinking, yes, that was some 16 years back. So things might have changed in Kashmir. And let me give you another example. And that happened just 2 months ago. One of the most prominent scholars of America, and I would tell you that he is one of the most prominent even in the world, Professor Noam Chomsky of IIT, he was interviewed by an Indian technology reporter, Mr. Ramanathan. And Professor Chomsky told him just 2 months ago that Kashmir has become the prison for the people of Kashmir, and the government of India is responsible for that. But he said much more important than that. He said that what is happening in Kashmir, no one knows that. So that's exactly what Dr. Kazi and Dr. Mir was telling you, that there has been Indian military crackdown for the last 10 months, and there is a coronavirus lockdown for the last 2 to 3 months. And the government of India knows that the world powers and the international NGOs, so they are engaged right now with this coronavirus pandemic. They cannot pay attention to the situation, to the suffering and the miseries of the people of Kashmir. So they have intensified their atrocities in Kashmir. And let me tell you that today when I am talking to you, so the whole valley of Kashmir has been declared as a red zone. A red zone means no one can come in and no one can go out. Dr. Kazi very correctly told you, and everybody knows that, that we have been also in the lockdown here in the West, here in Washington, in America, only for the last 3 months. People have started getting frustrated. People have started getting irritated. People have started getting angry. But at least there is one thing, as Dr. Kazi mentioned, that we can go out, we can vent our anger and frustration on the streets in the protest. So you may be thinking, yes, it is true that the people of Kashmir may not have the freedom of expression. But what about, can they vent their anger? Can they vent their frustration coming on the streets? Ladies and gentlemen, dear brothers and sisters, you cannot utter a single word in Kashmir about the situation, what is going on there. If you are a reporter, you can report anything you want to report. But you cannot report what Indian Army is doing in Kashmir. And it is not what I am talking. This is the Committee for Protection of Journalists, which is based in New York. They said only 10 days ago, they said the news media, this is the exact quote of Committee for Protection of Journalists, the news media has been pushed to the brink of extinction in Kashmir. And they also said it is simply because the Indian government, they want to silence the people of Kashmir. So ladies and gentlemen, I am going to give you only one example. We have Gauhar Gilani, one of the topmost journalists of Kashmir. What did he do? He wrote, and let me quote him, "The normalcy in Kashmir will be the peace in the graveyard. The normalcy in Kashmir will be the peace in graveyard." The Indian army came, he was picked up and booked under UFA. UFA is Unlawful Activity Prevention Act. It's a draconian law. Under this act, you can be declared as a terrorist. You cannot move to the court and you cannot be bailed out. Now you may be thinking that UFA is in violation of 4 important articles of Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Article 7, Article 9, Article 10, Article 11. It is also in violation of 4 articles of International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights. Article 6, 19, 20, and 21. You may be thinking that these are international obligations every member country of the United Nations have to abide by. Ladies and gentlemen, India doesn't care about that. Why it does not care that what exactly Dr. Mir was pointing towards? Because India knows India is the largest, rather fifth largest economy in the world. India knows if I am going to violate all these international norms, the world power, they are going to remain silent. India knows if I am going to break all these international obligations and covenants, the silence of world powers is going to give me the impunity in Kashmir. Ladies and gentlemen, just imagine, you are under Indian military crackdown. You are under coronavirus lockdown. You cannot speak. You cannot protest. You cannot go to the mosque. You cannot use the internet. You do not know whether you have anything to eat by the end of the day. You cannot vent your frustration and your anger on the streets. So what is the situation in Kashmir? So this was described by the New York Times. New York Times said Kashmir has become the hell for the people of Kashmir. Dr. Mir mentioned about the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom. I am going to tell you later on what exactly it says, but one of the things it says that India is the largest democracy. Ladies and gentlemen, don't listen to Dr. Kazi and Dr. Mir. Huffington Post says that Indian democracy in Kashmir is dead. Dr. Mir mentioned about this abrogation of Article 370, 35A. Let me say very briefly, before quoting any international dignitary or international agency, let me quote one of the most prominent leader of Indian parliament, who happened to be the former minister of interior, former minister of finance of government of India, one of the top leaders of Indian National Congress, P. Chandambaram. P. Chandambaram said that the abrogation of Article 370 is the biggest man-made disaster of India. Then he said, I do not want to say it, but I am compelled to say it, that abrogation of Article 370 is the beginning of disintegration of India. The people of Kashmir, they do not want disintegration of India. And Dr. Mir said very correctly, we have hundreds of Indian friends in America, even in India. We love the people of India, but this is the leader of Indian National Congress saying this is the biggest mistake. It may lead to the disintegration of India. Narendra Modi thought that he was going to abrogate Article 370 and make Kashmir integral part of India, and no one is going to know it. Even if anyone is going to know it, it will be only between India and Pakistan. So God has his own plan. this reckless activity and action of Narendra Modi, it brought the issue of Kashmir first time within the past 48 years back to the Security Council where it belongs. And India wanted it to be the integral part. Antonio Guterres, the Secretary General of United Nations, he said, Kashmir has to be resolved under the United Nations Security Council of resolution. When the whole world was knocking the door of India, that what are you doing there? There are atrocities, there is torture, Kashmiris are under siege. The custodian of human rights, the High Commissioner on Human Rights, you know how she responded to this claim of India, it's an internal matter? The High Commissioner of India said, both to both India and Pakistan, this is the time you have to give the right to self-determination to the people of Kashmir, exact wording. And she went one step ahead of it and she said, in future dialogue, you have to include the people of Kashmir to the talks. So ladies and gentlemen, when India would like to say that there's a normalcy, as Governor Gilani said, the normalcy comes only from the graveyard. But India said there's a normalcy. We have one of the most renowned and respected human rights activists from India, Arundhati Roy. She said on October 3rd, 2019, she said the 900,000 Indian military has made Kashmir the largest military concentration anywhere in the world. So ladies and gentlemen, these are the facts. This is what is happening in Kashmir. Now the question is that what can we do? We can do many things, but the question is whether it will have impact or not. There are few things it can have directly impact on the streets of Kashmir, on the streets of India, and it may bring India and Pakistan closer so that a time comes when they are going to really think about the future of the people of Kashmir. Number one, all those people who are listening to us, who are watching to us, they are going to listen to this video later on. What is more important and what is more effective is the use of social media. It does not need any financial support. It only needs intellectual support. I am glad that everyone who is listening to this video, he has the intellectual support. He has the power of the pen. You can use the social media. Why it is important, let me tell you, from 2016, the whole nature of Kashmiri political resistance has changed. It changed because of one single person. And that single person was 22 years old. His name was Burhan Wani. Let me also tell you, Burhan Wani always hanged a gun under his shoulder. But we have General Sibdain of India, who was stationed in Kashmir for 4 years. He wrote in one of the most important newspapers of India. I read it from the newspaper. He wrote, Burhan Wani had the gun, but he never used it. General Sibdain saying it. What was he using? He was using the social media. So that's why everybody who really would like to help Kashmir, for that matter, any oppressed people of the world, whether Hindus or non-Muslims, it doesn't matter. As long as they are oppressed, please use your pen and intellect and use the social media. And in this context, use it for the people of Kashmir. And secondly, very important, Dr. Mir mentioned, United States Commission on International Religious Freedom. They made few recommendations. They did not make it just for academic discussion. They made these recommendations so that the impact of these recommendations is going to be felt in the Parliament of India. It's going to be felt on the streets of New Delhi. What is the first recommendation? Exact wording. The BJP government, not Indian government, the wording is the BJP government must denounce the militancy of RSS, which is responsible for violence and responsible for discrimination. And the commission recommended there must be targeted sanctions. Can you believe it? Coming from the most important segment of United States State Department, there must be the targeted sanctions against agencies and individuals who are responsible for the religious discrimination. One more recommendation, their assets in America and elsewhere must be frozen. And number four, they must be banned to enter into America. Why this fourth one is important? Because you know that even Narendra Modi, in 2005, when he wanted to come to India, he was the chief minister of Gujarat. He has diplomatic passport. His diplomatic visa was rejected. Then he got the visit visa. That visit visa was revoked. Why I am saying so? I am saying it because we must initiate a campaign. We means everybody. In fact, I am telling you that the Indian Americans, they have started initiating this campaign, what I am going to tell you. We must make sure that global village or global community understands this RS is a terrorist organization and it must be declared by those who matter. The United Nations, the United States, the European Union, they must declare it as a terrorist organization. Number third, particularly to our Muslim American leadership. And I'm glad that I am talking from a very important platform of one of the most important Islamic organization in America. Yesterday, government of Pakistan announced something. They announced, it is a, by the way, bipartisan, it is government of Pakistan, it's the leader of opposition, it is the, there's a unanimous consent on that. The Friday, which is the Jumatul Wida, which is coming day after tomorrow, it must be celebrated as a Yomul Quds and Yomul Kashmir. It will be a day of Palestine and day of Kashmir. And I appeal to the leadership of American Muslim community, irrespective of which organization they belong to, irrespective of which Islamic center they belong to, if they can make a dua on the Jumatul Wida, I know there are not going to be congregations, but there is going to be a, anyway, we are going to celebrate the Jumatul Wida at our houses. We must make a special prayer for Al-Quds and for Kashmir, for Rohingya, for all the people who are really under the occupation and under oppression. And lastly, our youth. It is ultimately the youth which will be very active on social media too. But they can do one more thing. If not today, if not tomorrow, I am sure that the colleges and universities, they are going to be open. Whenever they are going to be open, if they can really have the seminars and conferences on the issue of Kashmir on their campuses, and like this, they can even, those student organizations, they can have the webinars like this on Kashmir. So by galvanizing the global community, by creating an awareness, that's exactly what is going on. Dr. Mir mentioned that it was only day before yesterday, 20 houses were gutted out, 20 houses. And I was listening to the chairman of the local mosque in Kanimazar. I was listening to him on video. So he said the estimate, and obviously the estimate is not final, the estimate is 450 million Indian rupees. That is what happened just in one single night. And it is happening almost every week. And every week there are multiple people, they are being, innocent people, they are being killed. So with the support of our community and with the support of the Friends of Kashmir and with the support of the those people who really have the conscience, Professor Noam Chomsky, he is not a Muslim. And you do not really need to be a Muslim to support the people who are oppressed. You do not need to be a Kashmiri to support the cause of Kashmir. You do not really need to be a from Myanmar to support these Rohingya people who are suffering in their these refugee camps. But as long as you are a human being, as long as you have a conscience, as long as that conscience clicks you and knocks your heart and mind, so you can help the people of Kashmir, you can help the people who are oppressed in any part of the world, irrespective of their religious affiliation, irrespective of their regional background. So with that, may Allah bless you. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.